Before starting a software project, do you plan it first before diving into the coding? Or do you decide the structure of the project along the way? Do you ever end up writing redundant copies of variables and functions? Or have you forgotten where you stored a particular variable and had to skim through your code only to find out that it was left in an irrelevant class? If you have, you're not alone. Coding projects often expand too quickly that if you didn't plan ahead, soon you'll feel lost and want to abandon the whole commit and restart. Whether your project is small or big, drawing out a class diagram will only help you reach your goal faster. It will help you keep track of the progress. So I will talk about how to make a class diagram for your game or other software projects. A class diagram consists of individual classes that you will need to complete the project, thus the name. It can also contain variables inside each class and the connections to represent the relationships between the classes. Now to start, first you need to choose which classes you are going to use. For example, I'm making a strategy game. It contains a map and the map will be made of tiles. So I created a map class that manages all the tiles in one place. Also a pathfinding class which will communicate with the map to draw the routes for our armies. Then I know I will have parties as a form of armies on the map, so that could be another class. Each party is going to be composed of units, which I call recruits. So I created a party class and a recruit class. I know that each recruit has to store information that is going to change during the gameplay, such as experience. But it will also have some information that won't change, such as how much it will cost to build them or how much I will need to upkeep. So I created two separate classes, recruit type and recruitment classes. One will keep information on how to make a recruit and the other will hold information on how they will behave. Next, I'll type in the information that each will contain. For example, hit points, which is an integer type, will change during gameplay, so it will go into the recruit class. I can also mark these variables as static if I want. Then I need to draw relations. These relations will indicate that I referenced one class inside the other. For instance, every party will contain references to instances of recruits. So I create a connection between the recruits variable of the party and the recruit class. Once these connections are made, then I suggest to add cardinality to those relations. Now, what I mean by cardinality? Cardinality indicates how many different instances of a class may be associated with one instance of the other class. For example, a party of recruits has to take at least one or more number of recruits. This means the recruit at the end of this relationship will receive this symbol, meaning at least one. But from the recruit's perspective, a recruit can participate in one party or none at all. Then the party end of the relation receives this, meaning 0 or 1. Whatever the programming language you're using, as long as it is an object-oriented programming language, you can inherit one class from at least another. Choosing which class to inherit from is actually a very deep subject that will require a video of its own. But briefly, if you're working on a Unity project and you have the data that will be required in every game session or the scene, you may prefer to store it as scriptable objects. In this case, recruit types can be a good example since independent from the map, I will need this data at every game session. Things that will be specific to each level can be model behaviors, such as recruits, since every scenario there will be different numbers of recruits. Then there is data that you will need for every scene, but it will change during the gameplay. For example, technological progress. At the beginning of the game, I need them to start from the same values and change as the game progresses. Now, it can be stored in two ways. Either they can be monobehaviors and be stored inside prefabs, or they can be scriptable objects that can be copied into the scene at the beginning of every level. But this is also about how you want to use the scenes. If you will use the scene as levels, then prefab is a good choice. But if you plan to have one scene for the gameplay and update the scene at the beginning depending on the initial settings such as the number of players and more player colors, then scriptable object makes more sense. Also, not every class has to inherit from something else. For example, each tech node is referenced by only one tech tree and doesn't need to be referred by any other. So, no need to make it inherit from another scriptable object. Instead, we make sure this class is also serializable and it exists inside a tech tree scriptable object. And finally, once all connections and inheritances are complete, I suggest scanning the diagram for one-to-one connections. Especially if they are between the classes that inherited from the same types, usually you don't have to have separate classes. They can be fused into a single class to avoid clutter. With this, we have a general idea about the structure of our software. It can change along the way, and I suggest as it changes, update it, so you won't lose a track of the progress. Having an updated class diagram will help you isolate individual systems, avoid writing redundant code, and avoid turning the whole project into a tangled mess. I hope this will help you realize your goals faster and get rid of your problems even before they occur. Good luck, and please subscribe so you won't miss the next video.